Welcome back to this free training series on FEMA P-154, Rapid Visual Screening of Buildings for Potential Seismic Hazard, brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency's National Earthquake Technical Assistance Program. This module will be the concluding module. You're watching the final of 9 training videos outlined here. Module 1 was an introduction to FEMA P-154. Module 2 went over earthquake hazard and seismic performance of buildings. Modules 3 and 4 went over the Rapid Visual Screening or RVS process itself. Module 5 outlined some key building performance indicators. Module 6 and 7 went over FEMA building types. Module 8 was a class exercise. And this module, Module 9, will go over some concluding remarks.
Welcome to Module 9. In this module, we're going to have some concluding remarks. We're going to talk about additional tools for electronic scoring, some additional resources that are available, and some concluding remarks. So electronic scoring is an optional process where scores are calculated electronically rather than using the paper scores. So there's several things that we can do. We can input, we can make a spreadsheet that has all the basic scores and modifiers and input which modifiers apply and calculate scores electronically in that way. There's also ways that we can refine the basic scores and the score modifiers for the specific seismic hazard that we have. So seismic hazard is taken at 5 different seismic hazard levels. We have very high, moderately high, moderate, and low. And if we have a community that falls in between moderately high and high, we don't necessarily have to use the high values. We could, using all the background information contained in FEMA 155, develop our own scores, basic scores and score modifiers for our specific seismicity. This is a larger undertaking that would require a lot of expertise, but could be done for larger RVS programs. So that is another way to do electronic scoring. FEMA P-155 provides all the background information about how the scores were developed for FEMA 154, and that process could be replicated to create your own electronic scoring. A parametric study was performed to compare the scores developed from electronic scoring versus paper-based scoring. In that particular study, 6% of the time, the paper score was less than 2 and the electronic score was greater than 2, meaning that 6% of the time, we were able to take a building that would have been sent to further evaluation and make it show up as greater than 2, so above the cutoff score. And in that same study, 1% of the time, a paper score was greater than 2. So the building was deemed to not require further evaluation, but the electronic score said, hold on, this building does need further evaluation. So generally, the paper score is a little bit more on the conservative side and will send more of your buildings to the further evaluation pile. And this shows that the final scores for electronic scoring were 56% of the time they were higher, 14% of the time they were lower, and 30% of the time they were unchanged. So there are tools available to do electronic scoring. One of them is ROVR, Rapid Observation of Vulnerability and Estimation of Risk. ROVR was developed to implement the second edition of FEMA 154, and it also is used to do rapid evaluations post-earthquake according to ATC 20 methodology. And it's a tool that can be downloaded onto a computer or tablet. There are ways to make it work on a smartphone, although it's not just as simple as downloading an app. And it's a great way to record information in the field directly into your electronics, and then it gets passed directly into a database. So on the right is a photo of the of the FEMA 154 form. You'll notice it's a little bit less busy than the third edition because this is the second edition of the form. And this is the output from Rover. This is a form that has a picture of the house that was being evaluated and a map of the property. QSEC has a more recent app that is available for rapid visual screening. This one is, you can see in the photo on the page, you can pull up the app on your smartphone and start putting information about your building and soil hazards and building modifiers. This will automatically generate a map, a Google map of your building, which is very helpful. And then the output after you're done with the rapid visual screening, it will create a FEMA P-154 data collection report for you. And it produces maps and GIS data and data that's compatible with HAZIS. HAZIS is the software that is the basis for all the scores and score modifiers. And putting your data back into that can help with loss estimates for your community and your portfolio of buildings. So when we have an app like this, where everybody's inputting information in the same way, it really increases efficiency and reduces errors that might be created when we're transcribing from paper to a spreadsheet or whatever other file system we have. This tool is specific to QSEC. So if you download this app and start inputting data, it will all go to QSEC. So if you want to create a version for your own program, there is some work involved, but there are resources available to help make that happen. Okay, these are additional resources. So FEMA P-154 is a cost-effective seismic assessment tool to rapidly assess earthquakes to buildings. We can assess this building that we see in this picture right here, but it's even better for large portfolios of buildings. It's accessible for a broad audience for implementation. We don't need screeners who are experts in seismic analysis and design. We can train a broad variety of individuals to perform this screening from the outside of buildings quickly, efficiently. And FEMA P-154 provides really valuable guidance on planning, managing, conducting an RVS program. Rapid visual screening results can be used for evaluating and ranking seismic retrofitting needs. They can be used for designing seismic mitigation programs. They can be used to develop building inventories, plan post-earthquake building safety evaluations, and develop seismic vulnerability information for programs that we don't even know are going to exist yet. They are so valuable in so many ways. All right, we have time for a question.
How might one begin to develop an RVS program?
Chapter 2 in the P-154 document talks pretty extensively about planning aspects for an RVS program. The main or primary point one starts with is developing a scope and budget being probably one of the more applicable things in terms of how you're going to conduct it. That kind of drives everything. But that's going to establish your scope of work, how many buildings you're going to want to review, for instance. And then it gets into the who's going to manage that program that you've established or looking to establish. And then who are you going to be using for screeners? And then beyond that, looking at doing the pre-field planning aspects and trying to get design professionals, the supervising engineer involved, which is a structural engineer, to really help and guide to assist with the program and do some quality assurance at the end of it. And then decisions are obviously going to have to be made about screeners, who you're going to have, who you're going to do. Are they going to be graduate students? They're going to be all design professionals. Are you going to train volunteers? So there's a lot of decisions to be made there. But the P-154 document talks pretty at length in terms of how to establish an RVS program where you've got a lot of buildings you're looking at, which is what it is geared for to do in a very effective manner.
And what other resources are there for training for screeners?
For screeners, this is a shortened version of the full-length NETAP training for 154 and screeners. And so although one could possibly take this training, having not seen it before, and go out and do some screens, it's highly encouraged that you sit through the full NETAP training for P154, which is offered for free through the Applied Technology Council. And from there, getting into the P154 document is highly requested or suggested in terms of providing additional knowledge, particularly if you're not a structural engineer, for one to become a screener. Like we mentioned throughout in several places, is if you had misidentified the building type, you are going to incorrectly score the building, which could have detrimental impact on the data that you collect in there, and then from there, utilize that data in managing a mitigation program. So it's imperative you identify the correct building type. And so as much information that you can get, knowledge about how to assess buildings, is going to be very beneficial. And that's where the supervising engineer to do a quality assurance check comes into play if you use volunteers that don't have that necessary knowledge. But the NETAP training the full NETAP training for P154 is a great start to actually get more information about how best to screen buildings.
All right, thank you, Mike and Sarah. So this marks the end of module 9 and concludes this free training series on FEMA P-154, Rapid Visual Screening of Buildings for Potential Seismic Hazards.